Mic check, mic check.
Okay, half the time I was singing, I was mic.
Okay, thanks for indulging us while we did just a little bit of a check the...
Checkpoint Charlie,
check the mics, check. Cool. For anybody that's ever seen Brooklyn 99. Okay, so a couple of announcements. Don't forget cloud-covered streets that are Monday, Wednesday, Fridays. We've got some sheets for them over there that tell you when and where they are, and you can take a shower and do laundry, and they give you a clean set of clothes, and they have snacks, and they have haircuts sometimes here and there. And then don't forget our Zedekah box, which is our offering box over here. If you got a penny, put it in, because Jesus can do a whole lot with a penny. The sweet little widow that gave
two mites,
thank you. I was like, what are two something?
They weren't termites.
No, not termites. Two mites that equals one penny. And Jesus said, I tell you, she's given more than anybody else here today because she gave out of her desperateness while other people gave out of their abundance. So that describes our community.
There is a chapel in Pennsylvania. A little girl back in the 40s was turned down going to the church because the pastor said they didn't have enough space for one more little girl. And
when she was very impoverished.
It was bad. So later on, when she had died and that pastor was called to take care of the state of the body, and when they got there and they were digging around her stuff, they found a little purse that she had found, and she had saved 37 cents. Mm-hmm. And as a note in there, that it was for that church so that they could have enough space to have everybody have space.
For
so
the children.
The pastor took that note and showed everybody and read it. Well, the press got a hold of it, and people started giving money, and then they ran it in the newspaper, and it made national syndicate, and people started sending in tons of funds. That church now is, I think it's
a huge church.
Calvary Cathedral in Pennsylvania or something. It's a huge church. It's like four city blocks, and then there's the Children's Annex. That's another four city blocks. And the moral to that story was, look what God can do with 37 cents. It's that church is still there. That wallet, the little purse, and her picture, and that pastor is there in the main hallway.
Yeah. Pretty cool. There you go. That's what he does with us, completely. So, I know this is going to surprise y'all that I'm going to say this, but I am so excited about what God's going to share with us today. But before we hear from him, we want him to hear from us. So, we've got the Zedekah box. Don't forget cloud-covered streets. The needs list is over here. And then don't forget, if you've requested needs list items after church, don't forget to pick them up before you leave. And I think that's all the announcements. Father, we just praise you today. We thank you for what you're doing for us. We thank you that you have taken our 37 cents and turned this into United Bible Community, and that we are the apple of your eye. And because we know that our picture is on your fridge and we know that our picture is in your wallet, we know how much you love us. And we want to sing praises to you, and we want to worship you because of who you are, because you're our daddy, because of the love that you have for us, because of the price that you paid when you gave your son. And so as we sing and we worship, will you receive it into the throne room? I'm serious. It just goes out of this atmosphere, through the second heaven, into the third heaven, into your throne room, and it just glorifies you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Y'all stand up. Let's worship.
You are the well, the one I'm driving. After a night.
After a night.
I will remember you're with me in this fight. Although the battle he rages on, the war's already won. I know the war's already won. Surely my God.
Sit with you a while again. Nonnie said, Pastor Mary said she really liked that. At home, she's Nonnie.
Thank you.
You guys ready?
Here
we go. 1, 8, 9, 6.
That we have had the opportunity to worship you, our meager widow's mite offering that we have brought to you today, at least in my life, is just a drop in the bucket of my gratitude for all that you've done in my life, and what you've done in this church, and the lives that you've touched in this church, the hundreds over the 7.5 years we've been down here. You are worthy to be praised. And it's because of the rock that you built the church on that we have any life whatsoever. That we have the blessings upon blessings that we don't even realize we have. We woke up today with breath in our lungs. That blessing is enormous compared to those that didn't and were not ready for eternity. I thank you that you have showed us what it means to be just a spicy disaster like Peter was, and yet be called by you to be used by you so that he could evangelize the world, so that today we can stand here and speak about who you are and the price that Jesus paid, so that we no longer have to be orphans, that we can be sons and daughters, And that while he was a spicy disaster, you turned him into a pillar of the church. And I'm asking that you move heaven and earth today, that you put a hedge of protection around this consecrated ground that we're standing on, so that we can speak your word, so that we can hear from you, so that eyes and ears and minds and hearts can be opened, and that we can walk away changed, because that's who you are. So speak to us, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. So on the top of your worship paper, I'm going to move back maybe a little bit more, see if I'm not hurt myself. On the top of your worship paper, which is the paper for you to keep, in big bold letters it says, keep this sheet. It was made for you to worship and reflect on your own time. So you take it with you. It's got the weather on there. It should just have a bunch of little cactuses, but it's just, you know, hot. And then there's a little cartoon. Let's see what the cartoon is this week. Hey, Pete, new candidate arriving in 3, 2. Oh, that's pretty funny. That confirms why I'm not jumping out of an airplane, y'all. Right there. I used to want to skydive. That was on my bucket list. I always wanted to fall tandem out of an airplane and skydive until 10, 12 years ago. I sat on the top of a 3-story building to do a zip line, and I climbed up there, and I sat my butt down on the edge with my feet hanging over, and there's 3-story, and not only the tower did this as you climbed up, and I'm up there, and as soon as I sat down, my butt grew like roots. I was not going anywhere. I was like, I can't fall on this thing. I can't do this. There's no way I can do it, because there's just a mindset of security, because the way this worked is you had this harness on that had this rope that was attached with a carabiner, and it was attached to another rope that went, I don't know, football field's length down, and it clicked on, but this was not a taut string. You had to hold it up from here, and then there was this loop, then it connected there, so that when you fell off, it absorbed the whatever, it made it straight.
And you said Jake Frost,
nope. Now, just before me, were you on that retreat, Evelyn? Do you remember this? We were at Riverbend Retreat Center. So just before this, because they would do 2 people at once, and if one went, that person couldn't get off the harness. They're hanging. They couldn't get off the harness until the other person went. So it was like, I mean, you both were supposed to go. You're supposed to go at the same time, but if you didn't, I mean, they were used to that. Mind you, the one that went just before me and the set of two was my 9-year-old grandson, who just climbed up there and hopped off like it was nothing. So I'm standing there, and I have just really come attached to this platform, and I'm holding this rope with, you know, about 2 feet worth of slack. So if I could have held from here and jumped off, I would have felt more secure. But if you held from here and jumped off, it rips your arms up. So that's why you have to hold from here. So I'm holding from here going, I can do this, Lord. No, I can't do this. I can do this, Lord. No, I can't do this. I can do this, Lord. No, I can't do this. Then my grandson from the bottom goes, Nani, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I was like, oh, I have to go now. And so I did. And I've done it several times since then, but I'm not jumping out of an airplane. I have officially erased that from my bucket list. So, nope. Cool. So, 2 weeks ago, I've been on fire for this water walking faith idea. This mantra that we need in our lives of having an understanding that water walking faith is the only kind of faith to have. And so, 2 weeks ago, I just introduced Peter, our sweet little Peter, being on the boat. We are in Matthew 14 today, if you want to get there. And passcode's required. I talked about what kind of faith it has to walk on water. Now, I have walked in water. I have sank in water. I have swam in water. I have almost drowned in water. I have played in water. I have floated in water. But I have...
Huh?
Oh, that was very unsuccessful. I did not have any arm strength. I got drug across water. I did not ski. I got drug across water once. And I just... And so, but I have never, ever, ever walked on water. So walking on water requires a kind of faith that is above and beyond the norm, okay? There were 12 disciples in that boat that day. They all saw the ghost, what they thought was coming to him, a ghost, and we'll read this again here in a minute. And Jesus replied to all of them, "I am. It's me, guys. Chill out." But only one of them, one of 12, had the faith to get out of the boat. Not just get out of the boat, but he said, "Lord, if that's you, call me to you." And so, because Jesus didn't say it first, Peter asked, and Jesus replied. And so, having water-walking faith doesn't make you more saved than any other believer, but it changes your experience with Jesus. Hear me. It changes your experience with Jesus. It grows you more intimately in a relationship with the Father. It changes the power that you have in you and the courage that you have in you to get out of the boat, stay out of the boat, not get back in the boat, and to walk on water to Jesus, to the point that if God calls you to pray for somebody that you're in line with at 7-Eleven, you pray for them. To the point that if God calls you to give away the last dollar that you have in your wallet, it's the only dollar you've had, you've kept it for 2 weeks, and you're saving it in an emergency, and he calls you to give it to someone who maybe is even driving a car or has a roof, water walking faith is different. It changes the experience that you have with Jesus. And then it is the difference between having your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Okay, commercial. Everybody know what that is? Once you get saved, once you become a born-again believer, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and it is there for eternity unless you ask God to erase it out. That's a whole other sermon, because you can ask to have your name removed because you don't want to spend eternity with the Father. But it is the difference between having your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life and experiencing the Lamb's life here on earth before we reach heaven. Did y'all hear me?
Yeah.
John 10:10 says that it is the thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, "I've come to give you life and life more abundantly." He didn't say anything about a roof. You hear me? He didn't say anything about having a roof. He said, "I came to give you life and life more abundantly." People just exist, and we squander the gift that Jesus died to give us. So having water-walking faith makes the difference in having your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life and then experiencing the Lamb's life here on earth. And then last week, we talked about the character traits of what a water walker has. Number one, he has obedience. Number two, he recognizes the shepherd's voice. Number three, he knows. He knows Jesus and the Father, and he trusts him. And then the part of the character of a water walker is complete surrender and then having a life of worship. I said last week, peace is not found in the absence of the storm, but in the presence of Jesus. Because I'm here to tell you, you will have storms in your life. The disciples had just been hanging with Jesus for 3 days and three nights, or however long it was, a multitude of days, 15,000 people. Jesus fed all of them with a little happy meal from a little fisherman's boy, and he fed all of those, and they had 12 baskets of food left over. So he took a happy meal. He took 5 loaves and 2 fishes and ended up feeding 15,000 people with 12 baskets left over. That's an abundant life. Don't eat the Happy Meal. Wait for the 12 baskets left over. You see what I'm saying? We need to be getting to the place that we are seeing God move. It's time to step out of the boat for our community. I've been preaching the same message for 7.5 years. It's time we start having some fruit. It's time we start having some fruit. So peace is not found in the absence of the storm, but in the presence of Jesus. Storms are going to come, y'all. With or without a roof. With or without a car. With or without benefits. With or without housing. With or without good health. With or without you're thinking you're doing right and the bottom falls out. Or you know you're doing wrong and there's still blessings ahead because God is wooing you into a relationship with Him. The storms are always there. It's about the peace that you have when Jesus is with you in the storm. So then, Matthew 14:22-29, and we're just going to read this one more time. We're going to stop at verse 29. But Matthew 14, I could have bookmarked it, but I lost my bookmark this week. starting in verse 22. As soon as the people were fed, Jesus told his disciples to get into their boat to go to the other side of the lake while he stayed behind to dismiss the people. After the crowds dispersed, Jesus went up into the hills to pray. And as night fell, he was there praying alone. So, sun's coming down, and these people are being dismissed. And he goes up into the hill to be alone with the Father and pray. I'm here to tell you, if Jesus Christ needs to pray with the Father, don't you think we need to? He spent lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of intimate time with the Father so that he would be close to him. He went up before sunset, but then it says, as night fell, he was there praying. He went up to pray, and he prayed all that time, and he was there praying alone. But the disciples, who were now in the middle of the lake, ran into trouble, for their boat was tossed about by the high winds and heavy seas. They were on the Sea of Galilee, and the Sea of Galilee is a very famous lake for just everything is peachy keen, and then wham! All of a sudden, there's some seas that killed lots and lots of fishermen and boats. And so they have rowed halfway across. You can't get the other halfway because they can't make it there. They can't get this first halfway back because they can't make it there. They're stuck like Chuck in the middle of the Galilean Sea with this humongous storm telling them what for. How many times have you been in your life where you feel stuck like Chuck and the storms just won't quit?
Yeah, right.
It doesn't matter. Jesus is in the boat with you.
That's right.
Are you with me? Say, it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
If Jesus is in the boat with you. Okay, so about 4 o'clock in the morning, let's put that in perspective. They left before sunset, and then by 4 o'clock in the morning, we're talking, they've been rowing for 8 hours, and they're halfway across the lake. They're stuck. They have been rowing. It's now about 4 o'clock in the morning. The ESV or the Kings or another version will say about the third hour. So the third hour was somewhere between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. So about 4 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came to them walking on the waves. Okay, so y'all been in storms. Y'all know what it's like to be outside in a storm. We took the grandkids camping at the beginning of summer, 1st of June, I guess it was. And we were at
Sulphur Springs.
We were out in East Texas.
Cooper Lake.
There you go. And the 2 or 3 separate times, storms rolled up. And I got to stand outside and video the electrical storm, the rain and the electrical storm and the thunder that would. There's one of my videos that in the middle of the video, it looks like right now. You could see absolutely everything. The lightning lit up so bright, it was as if it were noonday. It's pretty awesome, actually. That kind of stuff amazes me. And then Darin was like, you need to get back from the edge of the water because lightning strikes. There's a cliff there, and I don't pay attention. I just kind of wander around, and I'm videoing, and, you know. Anyway, and so, but they're on the Galilean Sea, and there is a storm going, and there was lightning, and all of a sudden they catch a glimpse of something. Did you see that? What was that? Did you see? I mean, because they're not close enough to the land. They're in the middle of this sea. They're halfway across, and lightning has, or something has brought to their attention. Wait a minute, that's not right. Did y'all see that? I mean, it's not like some humpback whale come up and did one of these kind of numbers. That's not in the Galilean Sea. There wasn't anything that... What was that? So, about 4 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came to them walking on the waves. And when the disciples saw him walking on top of the water, they were terrified and screamed, "A ghost!" Jesus wasn't in a boat. He wasn't on one of those little things that you stand on, whatever those things are called. You know what I'm talking about? It's kind of like a surfboard, but it's not. It's like a surfboard and a boat gave birth to this thing, whatever it is, that you stand on it. He wasn't on one of those. He wasn't in a boat coming to them. He was walking on the water, and they were like, I know we just witnessed something, and I know our brains are still connected, and I don't know what we just saw, but what? It's a ghost! That's all they were terrified. Then Jesus said, "Be brave, don't be afraid. I am here. It's me." If you read it in the ESV, it says, "It is me." He says, "Hey, you boneheads. We have just spent the last 2.5 years together. It's me. Of course, I'm pretty sure that never on their radar was Jesus walking on water.
Right.
This is the first time it had been done. They had seen people raised from the dead. They had seen people healed. They had seen lame walk. They had seen blind eyes open. They had seen deaf ears. They had seen all kinds of stuff. But not on their radar was seeing Jesus walk on water. Not on their radar was seeing and experiencing this, especially since they were already terrified that they were going to capsize in their boat and they were going to drown, float to the bottom, and be fishy food. They were not, that was not, are you with me? Y'all get what I'm painting a picture here. Y'all with me? So Peter shouted out, "Lord, if it's really you, then have me join you on the water." Now leave it to Peter to test the Lord. I mean, he is, like I said, a spicy disaster prior change, prior to the resurrection of Jesus. When Jesus came back, it was a game changer. When Jesus, now they were with him before crucifixion and raised from the dead. Their lives were impacted here. Their lives were radically changed here. This had never happened before. This was not something that, well, yeah, once in history we read scientifically it might could have happened. Steve, come get you a drink over here, baby, and come sit down. All right. So Peter's like, oh, yeah? What? Oh, yeah? What? Show me. If that's you, Lord, then have me come to you. There's nothing wrong with, and I think it's Isaiah. The Lord says, come, let us reason together.
Absolutely.
Come on. Bring your questions. Bring your concerns. Bring your, Lord, where were you? Okay? That's not sacrilegious. Come to him and give him a chance to explain to you what's going on so that you can have a deeper understanding of who he is and a much more intimate relationship with him. Just bring it on. Come bring it to me, Peter said. Lord, if that's you. They already knew his voice. They knew it was him.
That's religion that tells you don't ask questions.
I encourage questions. And I encourage you to chew your own food. Don't believe anything I tell you today. Go read it for yourself. Ask Holy Spirit to interpret it for you. Have your own revelation of it. So, he said, Lord, if it's really you, then have me join you on the water. And Jesus replied, come on. Come and join me. 12 disciples were in the boat. They all were scared to death, and they all screamed it was a ghost. Then Jesus replied to them, and only one said, I'm seeing what you're doing there. Okay, if that's you, call me out of the boat. Jesus said, come on, let's go. Let's bring this thing. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, one of them-ish.
Redneck version. He said,
aight, then. Aight, then. Redneck version. Come and join me. So Peter... There are no other voices, and there are no other scriptures. This is one whole sentence. Come and join me, Jesus replied. So Peter stepped out onto the water and began to walk towards Jesus. He didn't lay a mat out on the water first, so in hopes that he could kind of surf over that way. He didn't, like, stick his foot in the water and see how cold it was. Remember, all these waves, the boat's going like this the whole time. The boat's going back and forth the whole time, rocking and rolling, and these waves are crashing, and everything's coming in. And Peter just gets up and gets out of the boat. It's time we get out of the boat.
Yeah.
It is time we get out of the boat. Say, it's time,
it's time.
We get out of the boat. So Peter stepped out onto the water and began to walk towards Jesus. So we have an understanding of what water walking faith is. We know what the characteristics of a water walking faith person is, but what I want to talk to you today is one simple word, and it's called do. What did Peter do? What are you doing? Do. Peter had everything he needed, the idea, the intent, the instruction, and the invitation, and all that was left was action. God is calling each one of us, every single one of us, to get out of the boat, to live for him, not our lamb's book of life name on the register, but having the Lamb's life in our life here on earth. He is calling us to do something. Yeah. Jesus did something. He left heaven. He left everything that stood for him and he stood for up there in heaven as the Son of God. And he left there and he came to be like us. And he came here and he did a do thing. He do'd from there to here. It's not a word, but you know what I mean. All that was left was an action. He had to take the step and get out of the boat. Jesus had done his part. Now it was up to Peter to do his. Jesus has done his part in our lives. There isn't anything else that he can do that's going to give us the opportunity to be more saved. There isn't anything else that Jesus can do that's going to give us the opportunity to be more surrendered. There isn't anything else Jesus can do that's going to give us the ability to be more transformed. Are you with me? Yeah. Jesus has done his part. Whose responsibility is it now?
Ours.
Ball's in our court. Are you with me? The ball's in our court. So Peter is left with a choice. So he has stepped out like this. I don't know. It doesn't tell us. But I am wondering if Peter all of a sudden said, oh, I better get back in the boat. This was crazy. You with me?
Yeah.
All of a sudden, Peter is out on the water walking towards Jesus. And I can tell you, we'll talk next week about when his like business happened, okay? But he is on the course of doing, which is what we are supposed to be. Peter's left with a choice. Do I step back in? Do I step out? What am I doing? His mind would have been racing. His heart would have been pounding. He climbs up onto the ledge. And these were like boats that you go fishing in. They're not, what do you call those? Not John Deere. That's a tractor. John boats. You know, the little John boats. You know, it was not just a little bitty that's about, my daddy had one that's about this big and you had a little plane you could fish on. These are boats.
Right. Forget the Rembrandt painting.
Oh, yeah. These are boats. I mean, there was a little, he had to make and take, and he didn't just flop out onto the side accidentally because he said, okay, I will, and then all of a sudden, you know, it like in Moana, when the water spits Moana back up on the raft or, you know, whatever, and if you've seen it, you know what I mean.
There's enough room to hold 13 people.
Exactly. 13 grown men.
Grown men.
And so he didn't just like accidentally fall out onto the water. He had to make a concerted effort to get up to the edge and then out over onto the boat. Are you with me? So he climbs up onto the ledge of the boat and slowly raises one foot over the water, and his weight shifts from the boat to the sea. As he catches his breath, he realizes he's walking on water.
All right.
Here's where we are, y'all. Don't right. get back in the boat.
Right.
We're to be water walking, faith exhibiting believers, ambassadors for the kingdom, Christ followers. Are you with me?
Yeah.
So it's important to understand that we too can have everything that we need, but until we are willing to step out of the boat, until we're willing to take the risk, until we are willing to do something about it, nothing will happen.
Right.
If you're tired of your life the way it is, it's your fault. Don't come to me to cry on my shoulder. I am going to hold you accountable. I have given you the words of God straight from the throne room. While I have studied and I don't normally have preparation like this, sometimes I'm up here and I think we're going to talk about one thing and Holy Spirit starts to move and God starts talking and we talk about something different. But I'm here to tell you, he's been on me for this. Because I'm the shepherd of this flock. Let me put this into perspective. At one point in time, I will leave this earth and I'm going to step into the other side of time and I'm going to be in the presence of God. And then at some point after the great white throne judgment, hear me, I'm going to stand before the King of Kings and give an account for this church.
I'm going to be there and welcome you when you get there.
Yeah, I'm hoping we go at the same time. He already told me I can't die before him and leave him with all the mess of the farm and all that stuff. But anyway, that's a whole other story. But hear me, there is some trembling that goes on within me when I actually stop and think about that. There's some response. I'm going to tell the Lord, the King of the universe, the God of all creation, my daddy, the Alpha, the Omega, that Jesus is going to be right there on the mercy seat, and I'm going to give an account for how this church did its business. That's why I'm careful what I do. That's why I'm very careful what I do. It says, look, thank you. Thank you, Ruach.
I know, right?
It says that in that day, there will be people They step, like on left, this guy here says, we're going to have a newcomer in 3, 2, okay? When that judgment day, when that great white throne judgment happens, there's going to be people that step into the other side of time, and they're headed for the sign that says sheep, and whoever's going to be there directing with the little flags like airplanes or something maybe, they're going to be shuffled over to the goat line, and they're going to go, whoa, wait, what? Matthew 25, he says, wait a minute, Lord. We cast out demons in your name, and we fed the hungry, we clothed the naked, and we visited the sick, and we went to folks and visited them in prison. And if somebody was thirsty, we gave them a drink. And here's what Jesus says, I never knew you. Depart from me, workers of iniquity. You got to go pay for your own sins. Too bad, so sad. Sucks to be you. Straight up, literally. They will leave the presence of the Lord, and they will enter Sheol, and they will pay for every sin they have ever committed, and then they will cease to exist. Their spirit will burn up. They will not writhe in all hell in eternity. They will not writhe for all eternity in hell. That is not what Scripture says. Go study your word. It's been taught in church wrong for 200 years. That's not what it says. The place of hell, what we call hell, Sheol. This is a commercial, by the way. I didn't give you the heads up on that. But the place of Sheol, hell, the burning lake of fire and sulfur, that was created for Satan, for Lucifer, for the fallen angel, and all his minions. And they will burn in hell for all eternity. Humans, created in the image of the Father, we are body and we are spirit. And if we are born in the flesh, then we're going to die in the flesh. But if we're born in the spirit, then we're going to live for all eternity in the spirit, and we get a new body. But if we are born in the flesh and born in the spirit, then we're going to die in the spirit. We will never die in the spirit. Did I say that right?
No.
You're with me?
Jesus said,
if we are born in the flesh and born in the spirit, then we're going to die in the flesh. We will never die in the spirit. But those that have been born in the flesh, but never born in the spirit, there are people that are in church tomorrow, on Sunday, in a building, giving, writing out their little tithe check, and whatever, and they give to, you know, Compassion Kid, and they donate to sex trafficking rescues, and they go to AA 4 times a week, and whatever. If they've never actually been, they may have said a prayer, but saying a prayer is not being born in the spirit. That saying a prayer thing is just a bunch of malarkey Satan's infiltrated the church with about 125 years ago. Although there is something about coming to the Lord and going, I repent. When John, I'm really delineating here, but y'all hold on. When John the Baptist said, prepare ye the way of the Lord, he's coming. Repent, the Lord's coming. When Jesus taught the disciples, he said, repent and be born again. Then the disciples taught in the first generation and the second generation, repent and be born again. Repent and come be in a relationship with the Lord. Repent, kill off the orphanness, and come be a son and a daughter. But somehow this repent business has gone away. Because grace without change is adulterated. You don't get to pull the grace card, so you get to do what you want on Friday night.
That's right.
That's crap. Pardon me. You live for Jesus on Friday night, and Saturday morning, and Tuesday night, and Monday night, and all day Wednesday, and all day Sunday, and every 24/7, 365 days a year, and a little bit of extra for the leap year and all that kind of business. You live for Him every single day. Are you with me? There is no grace without repentance. So there's going to be a whole lot of people that are heading towards that sheep line, and they're going to get directed towards the goat line, because it says, hear me, this verse makes me tremble. I don't know where it is, look it up yourself. But it says that Satan will fool even the very elect, if possible.
The Revelation.
I gotta be on guard. Because my enemy roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he can devour. Okay, he devoured me for long years, many, many years, while I called myself Christian, but I didn't live it. There was no fruit on my tree, and there was no fruit for somebody else to pick, and there was no ambassadorship going on here. That's not water walking faith.
Right.
Don't call yourself Christian if there's not fruit growing on your tree that looks like the fruit of the Spirit.
Right.
We're given we are given when we get born again, truly born again. It's not repeat a prayer after me. It's kill your orphan self and live in your son or daughtership life, and you're being transformed into the likeness of Christ. And then we walk around in the freedom of life. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed.
Whoa.
Whether you got a tent or not, whether you got a house or not, whether you have a job or not, whether you have benefits or not, whether people like you or not. Let me just tell you, I've had more people hate me since I've become a pastor than I did when I was the B word. I could find all kinds of friends back then.
Yeah.
All you had to do was get drunk and yell and scream at each other and maybe have a little cat fight or something, and then you're all still friends the next day and no big deal. I have hate mail all the time. I've had my life threatened. There are people that don't like me. But it's not people, it's the enemy.
Yes.
Because I don't wrestle against flesh and blood.
Yes.
I don't. My war is not with you. My war is in the unseen, and I'm going to battle the demons that you have accidentally bought a lie from, and you're going to come against me, and it's not me. It's the presence of the Lord that I carry. And so we're going to go to war. We'll go to war, and I'm here to tell you, I already won. Just hang it up, because I've already ready won. I won because I'm on his team, because he already won.
Yeah.
Because when he was raised from the dead, he conquered sin and death, and it was a game changer. We are living in the game-changing times. Another commercial. We are commercialing today. In Matthew 24, 25, 26, somewhere in there. And I'm sure it's in the other Gospels, but Matthew is the one I always go to. Jesus has come back. He walked on this earth for 50 days. And he saw his immediate 12. And he saw, well, immediate 11. And then a 12th one was added because poor Judas, bless his heart. That's a whole other story too. But then he appeared to more than 500 people in the 50 days that he was here. He had the hands, the scars, the holes. He had the holes to prove it. He had the holes to prove it. He had the wound in his side to show where the sword had stabbed him so that his legs wouldn't be broken to fulfill a prophecy. Okay, so then he's talking to the guys because they're a little bit distraught and not understanding exactly what's happening because the forest was too close for them to see the trees, you know what I'm saying, or however that, whatever that saying is, you know, they couldn't really, and so they're like, well, when are you going to come back, Lord? When are you going to come back? Because he said, I got to leave, I'm sending somebody else to help you, but I'm coming back. But when are you going to come back? So he gives this dissertation. The first thing he says is to watch the fig tree. When you see it ripen, when you see the buds begin to grow, and you see that the fruit is beginning to ripen, know that the figs are going to fall. It's time for harvest. Watch the fig tree. So the fig tree is Jerusalem. The fig tree is the nation of Israel. Now, you just got to look at a world map to see the tiny size of Israel compared to the entire world land, okay? We have the world land, and then we have Israel about this big here that has been, that land has been fought over for all of creation since the flood. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
It's tiny. It makes no sense. If something's happening and it doesn't make sense, then one of two teams is involved. One of unseen teams is involved. So there's a fight over this little tiny piece of land. So Jesus says, watch the fig tree. Then there will be wars and rumors of wars. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. There will be pestilence. There will be diseases. And when all of these things are happening, then you know that my return is very near. But then he goes on to say, only the Father knows the day and the hour. The day and the hour. We should know the season. If we are reading and studying this word and looking at Revelation, which is the playbook step by step for his return, we ought to be able to know when he's coming. And the closer he gets, the more we ought to be going, do you have water walking faith? Do you know Jesus? Can I share him with you? Do you know that you're a son or a daughter? Do you understand your identity? Do you know that sin and death doesn't have to reign in your life anymore, that you can be free? The closer he gets, the more we ought to be out loud about it. You with me?
Uh-huh.
Now, at some point, it's going to be against the law here. So, then Jesus left. And we're talking 33 AD, 70 AD, the temple was destroyed, all the Israelites were scattered, and Israel is not a nation anymore. And Israel, they were all gone. Okay, we're talking 2,000 years-ish. So there have been what I call chicken little people. The sky has fallen. The sky has fallen. Jesus is going to return. What was that guy's name? And they all drank the Kool-Aid or the other ones that were going to get on the ship that was coming because the sky has fallen and whatever. Jesus is coming back, and it's going to be on June 12, 1967, and we're all going to put on these full tin hats and wear the right kind of tennis shoes, and he's going to come pick us up. You cannot name the day.
That's right.
But you can know the season, because he started off with, watch the fig tree.
Right.
So, wars, rumors of wars, earthquakes in various places, famines, pestilence, diseases, that has happened every generation since Jesus left. With me? Because he says, before this generation passes away, I'm coming back. Will this generation win? Which generation? There's been a whole bunch of generations since 70 AD, since 33 AD. That's a whole bunch of generations between then and now. You with me so far? Are you listening? I hope you're listening. I hope even if you're asleep, you're listening. Hear me. Because Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. So before this generation, what generation? Oh wait, it's the generation that's watching the fig tree first, and then we got wars and rumors of wars, blah, 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 blah. We, me and Darin, whatever year you were born, my husband and I's generation is the only generation since Israel was not a nation that has all of the recipe, because Israel became a nation and they re-inhabited it in 1967. We're just waiting. And this bride in Revelation, it says the bride is making herself ready for the coming of the groom. He's not coming to pick us up to rescue us out of here. He's coming to pick us up for a wedding date, and then we're going to go have a wedding feast, and then all the rest of the stuff is, he's coming for a pickup date for a wedding. And the bride is making herself ready, and we should be water walkers. We should have water walking faith. Are you with me? He's coming back. He's coming back in my lifetime. Now, that doesn't mean I'll be alive. He's coming back in my lifetime, whatever this generation is. What am I? Boomers, thank you. I'm a boomer. He's coming back in the boomer generation. I talked to my cousin about it. My uncle died this week. My mom's brother. There's one more brother and one more sister. There was 9 children. My mom died 4 years ago this November. And my uncle passed away on the 23rd, and I got the phone call, prepared to go to the funeral. Dude, he was 90. He served honorably in the military. He had a military funeral. He was the mayor of Coppell. He opened umpteen stores. He had farms and cattle and loved family. And on the day before he died, he said, I'm going to heaven tomorrow. And he got to say goodbye to all his family. And he got to play one last round of 42. And then he went to be with Jesus. Man, you can't beat that. I'm just telling you, you can't beat that. That is awesome. But he stepped out of time, which is where we live, and into the presence of the Lord. Paul writes, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, there's a bunch of other scriptures, like those who sleep or unaware of stuff that's going on. I don't know if that's before Jesus and under the law or if it's under the grace. I don't know, but we're probably not going to know. We're going to know that we were here, and then we're going to know that we were there, no matter how much time is in between that. So I personally may not be here when the coming happens. I really, and I've said this many times, I really believe that Holy Spirit told me that I'm going to be decapitated and a martyr for the cause of Christ. Sign me up! Because I have water walking faith. Okay, so I'm talking to my cousin on the way back from the funeral, who is she's not even a spicy disaster. She is a hot mess. And we were best friends growing up. She's 16 months older than I am. And she just blah, 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 all the way home. Barbie something, stupid Barbie movie, and, you know, whatever, and Lynn Star, and this cute little dog she's got, and, you know. I said, okay, stop. We're getting close to your house. I have to talk to you about this. I have to talk to you about being a son or a daughter, about being a daughter of the one true king, about not living as an orphan. She goes, I have no idea what you're talking about. I said, I'm talking about being born again. Oh, I said a prayer. I said, girl, saying a prayer does not get your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if by chance you believed enough with enough knowledge of who he is that you really had a heartfelt conviction when you mumbled those words, I'm here to tell you there is not an ounce of fruit on your tree that shows that you're going to be in the sheep line when you step into heaven. So I'm here to tell you, I'm not sure. I can't see your heart, and I am not your judge. But I am not comfortable knowing that my cousin that I grew up with is going to be in that line when I'm in this line, and I'm not going to have you look at me and go, why didn't you tell me? I'm not going to do that. So we're going to continue to meet because I just... So I talked about that, you know, the second coming of Christ, and we're the first generation that's got the nation of Israel where they want to be, and all the prophecies have been fulfilled and ready to go for his coming. And I said, what do you think about that? She said, oh my gosh, it scares the poop out of me. I said, well, then there's right there is another piece of fruit that shows that you're not on the right team. That's a glorious thing. We have nothing to be afraid of. We have nothing to be afraid of. The Antichrist is going to reign. There's going to be one world government, one world religion, one world money. All of Christianity is going to be outlawed. And if you don't have the mark of the beast, you're not going to be able to buy a loaf of bread. You're not going to be able to stand in line for a sack lunch. You're not going to be able to get medical care. You're not going to have a job. It won't matter because God has always taken care of his remnant. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
He will rain pizzas if he has to. He will take care of us. So when you get through the trumpets, and you get when you get through the scrolls, and you get through the trumpets, and when you get to the bowls, this is my take. You do your study, you come up with your own, but this is my take. Because Jesus said, in this world you'll have tribulation. Paul said, at the sound of the last trumpet, the dead in Christ will rise, and all those that remain and are alive will be caught up with him in the air. We have scrolls. We have trumpets. At the sound of the last trumpet, Jesus said, you're going to have tribulation. But the great day we are spared from. And that great day, at the sound of the last trumpet, we're caught up with him in the air. And then what's left are the bowls, which is, this is the wrath of God. This is the great wrath of God. You know, you've had a spanking, and then you've had a whooping. And there's a difference between those two. Y'all with me? You know what I mean?
For real.
Had a spanking. You know, your mom took off her flip-flop and chased after you. But your daddy came after you with his belt. There's a difference in those two. One is the wrath of God. One is the great wrath of God. Now, mind you, my mindset has changed over time because I was like, oh, we're out here. God would never want us to see any of that kind of stuff. And then Holy Spirit said, what do you think Jesus meant when he said, you will have tribulation? Well, I don't know. I think I've ought to study that a little bit more. Okay? So, it says that not a hair of our head will be harmed. Some of us, it won't matter. Some of us have longer hairs. But, he's going to take care of his bride. He's going to take care of his bride. I don't know if you've ever been married, or been a part of a wedding or whatever. I'm telling you, the bride doesn't sit around eating wings and drinking beer with barbecue sauce all over her. And she's rubbed her hair, now it's got barbecue sauce in her wedding dress, and she's wiped her hands on it. And then she goes, oh, I'm ready for the wedding.
Right.
No bride has ever looked like that for a wedding. So if you're part of the bride, are you ready for the wedding? If you're part of the bride, where is your faith? And what are you doing about it? James tells us, so I'm going to go ahead and read this one. And we'll finish talking about this next week. James says that it's in James 1. There's two of them, James 1 and also in James 2. Go read it for yourself. Chew your own food. He said that we are not to be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. And that faith without works is dead. That's my cousin. That's where she's at. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I said a prayer. Remember, we went to church camp together in 1976. Where's the works? Now, we're not working our way there, but let me tell you, it's... Okay, I'll be honest. I'm not feeling very good today. I was not feeling very good coming up here. I got a serious neck issue. I'm just waiting for Jesus to heal. Jesus has supernaturally healed most of my back from yesterday. But this is a lot of work, y'all. This is the works. Because I have water walking faith.
There we go.
Because I love Him. I love Him. I love Him. Do you hear me? I will take a bullet. I will get my head chopped off. I will witness to the God that's at the guillotine because I love Him. I am not going because of my works. I'm going because of my love and my faith. I am not here just to get some bonus points. I'm here because I love Him. With water walking faith. Father, I just thank You for Your word today. Holy Spirit, for those that haven't comprehended the words that You spoke today, drive it home hard, hard for them. In their time when they're alone, in their time when they're meditating on something, I don't care if they're drunk, sober them up and drive it home in their sleep, in the dream, send people their way to talk to Him. Because I know, Jesus, You are coming back and the bride is to be getting ready. And the only way we're going to get ready is water walking faith. Teach us, Lord. Teach us. And I ask this humbly. Strip it all away that isn't from You. You cut it off with or without anesthesia, but remove it from our lives. Rip it out of our lives if it doesn't belong in a son or a daughter's life. Father, I'm giving You permission as shepherd of this flock that You do that to me and the sheep. Remove it. We don't want any orphan in us whatsoever. We want to be ready for our pickup date. We want water walking faith. We want our eyes on You. We want to be so madly, passionately, violently in love with You that it just oozes out of us with everything that we do, with every word that we say, with every action towards other people, with the choice of going back to the world, getting back in the boat, or staying out on the water and walking towards Jesus. Do a number in our lives so that when we come back together next week or we see each other Wednesday at Bible study or Thursday at Junk in the Trunk, there is such a drastic change. There's a Shekinah glory glow. Lord, that's what we want. Do it in me. We love You. We praise You. Thank You. We worship You. We thank You for sobriety and freedom. We thank You for healing. We thank You for deliverance. We thank You for unconditional love. We thank You for forgiveness. We thank You for grace with change. We thank You for grace that changes us. We thank You for mercy that changes us. We thank You most of all for that undying love that You used to die for us that continues to go on. And You intercede for us, Jesus. You rock my world. Father, You're my daddy. I ask that You develop that kind of relationship with every sheep of this flock, that they have an understanding, clear understanding of You as a daddy, not Father God that's going to smite us anytime, but as a daddy who lets us crawl up in His lap and You hold us and You love on us and You wipe away our tears and You kiss our boo-boos on our skin knees and You just help our lives change so that we look like Jesus. And Holy Spirit, hats off to You for having to put up with us, for living with us, and for being the helper and the guider and the comforter and the convictor of our souls. That conviction is what leads us to change. Do a number in this flock. I'm asking You. I'm begging You. Do a number in this flock. We thank You for our food. We thank You for providing it just supernaturally. We thank You for our needless things. We thank You just that we have family. I pray all of this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people who agree said,
Amen. Amen.